So today I'm going to be talking about something that we all have and we all use, and that is something called creativity. Okay? We think of creativity that is used in music, in art and poetry, but it's actually something that we all use. It's not just restricted to the arts. We use it to be able to adapt to change, to problem solve, and to innovate, whether we're innovating in the fields of business, science, or education. I would like to first talk about a 70-year-old patient of mine that came to my office. Both of her parents were very, very worried about her. This 7-year-old child was angry, hyperactive, and impulsive. She was able to make friends, but immediately would become physically aggressive to them. And her teacher saw that, you know, this physical aggression would lead her to more visits to the principal's office. So upon meeting her, I gave her a set of crayons and a piece of paper. And for the next 15 to 20 minutes, we drew. We drew together, and she created a new world, a world that involved pineapples, giraffes, and friendly aliens, okay? And then what I was noticing in this child was that she was not reacting. She was not angry. She was creating, okay? So what was going on when we were engaged in drawing, okay? There are three different types, parts of the brain that were activated as we were drawing. The first part of the brain was the prefrontal cortex. And this part of the brain is where the forehead is, which is our brain's manager. This allows us to plan, to organize, to filter out different ideas, whether we want to move forward with an idea or a behavior, or eliminate it because we don't think that it's necessary at this time. The other part of her brain that was activated was her temporal lobes, okay? And this is around the ear area over here, okay? The temporal lobe is responsible for sensorial processing, how we process sights, sounds, and emotions, and using that to make connections with previous experiences in order to develop new experiences and new ideas. The last part of the brain that was activated was her default mode network. There are two areas that we're exchanging here, okay? And as per the neuroscientist, Dr. Nancy Andreasen, she coins this area as the creative incubator, the prefrontal cortex and the temporal lobe, exchanging neuronal activity, going back and forth. The DMN is activated when we are daydreaming, when we are reflecting, when we are relaxing. Okay? So when working with this young child, her DMN was activated, okay? And it allowed me to enter her inner world in order to produce a product that was tangible and also intangible using creativity. Another patient of mine was a U.S. Army veteran. Well, upon being discharged from the U.S. Army, decided to take on two professions. Said one during the day, I'm a butcher. I slice meat, I provide sustenance for my family, and I make an income. And during night, he would engage in sculpting, okay, for a creative release so that he can process certain memories that he was enduring. He shared with me that he was experiencing successive nightly nightmares about what he experienced. He also experienced a lot of flashbacks during the day and was always hypervigilant. When out in public, he always assumed that everybody was a suspect. Okay. So there are two types of processes when it comes to creativity. There's divergent thinking, which is when we allow ourselves to free associate, to just write down any thought that comes to mind, to brainstorm without judgment, without filtering, okay, just releasing all that creative energy. There's also convergent thinking, which is where we narrow down and filter these ideas and make them practical and actionable. There is also a component of relaxation. When the veteran touched clay, that would help induce relaxation. Creativity occurs a lot when we are relaxed, whether we are taking a shower, going out for a walk, or in meditation. When we're relaxing, it allows our mind to be open and available to different ideas, to new ideas. So, if for this veteran, the DMN helped him access these troubled, difficult memories of him losing his battle buddies, and his hand held the other hand as he held the last breath. His prefrontal cortex allowed him to organize different thoughts and filter out what I'm going to do next for sculpting. And his temporal lobe was activated when he touched the clay and was able to mold and create different artworks. My last patient was a 12-year-old who had an obsession with Godzilla. And he also had difficulties with social skills, okay, interacting with adults and also with his classmates. And he also suffered from bouts of psychosis. Every single interaction with him began or ended with Godzilla, okay? Every conversation. And granted, we were all pretty fed up with Godzilla. But we saw this as an opportunity to help motivate him, okay? Because he was not engaged in learning. So, in this, by using Godzilla, we helped him instruct mathematics. We were asking, can you calculate what would be a budget to help reconstruct the Shibuya district of Tokyo after Godzilla destroys it? Reading assignments would involve character analyses between Godzilla, Sherlock Holmes, and Harry Potter. Okay? And writing prompts would involve, how would Godzilla feel if he lost a battle towards King Kong, and how can he redeem himself? How can he come back as a champion? Okay. So creativity here was not just in the students. It was also with his teachers, who had to find new ways on a daily basis to motivate him, to use Godzilla in new different ways. Here, his teachers were using a concept called neural mirroring, just a process where we can imitate the behaviors of others in order to enter their world, in order to elicit an empathic response with the other person. Also, dopamine played a major role in with the teachers as well. Okay, dopamine is a transmitter in which rewards when we take risks, okay, when we take new challenges, okay. And the more we do that, granted that they are safe risks, the more we are able to crystallize new information. So, how can we nurture our own creativity? And neuroscience tells us there's a couple things that we can do. And everybody is amenable to be creative. There's mindfulness, and there's relaxation techniques. Mindfulness is the ability to use your five senses to tap into the here and now, as opposed to thinking about the future or thinking about the past. Okay? And relaxation is the ability to reduce your responsibility momentarily in order to reallocate your attentional resources. Okay? When you're engaged in either mindfulness or relaxation, you are activating your DMN, your default mode network, to be open to new ideas. Also, engaging in divergent thinking exercises, okay? Brainstorming, okay? Free associative writing, okay? When I engage in a writer block, I asked one of my writer's friends, what can I do? What do you do? He told me, you know, just write the word blah, 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 and fill up a page. If you have to fill up 10 pages, so be it. As long as you are writing. Maybe not today, but maybe tomorrow, that creativity will be unlocked. Changing up your routine. Routine is mundane. It's not creative. Okay. If we change our routine, we are invoking neuroplasticity, okay? And that is when we engage in new behaviors and our brains adapt to those behaviors and hence rewire. There are some simple things that you can do to change your routine. For example, tonight, take a new route home, okay? Also, instead of using your dominant hand, I'm a righty, your dominant hand to brush your teeth, use your left hand. Okay, that will train your brain to become adaptive. Exploring creative hobbies, okay. Cooking, drawing, dancing, playing a new musical instrument. Okay. Each of these activities, and there's tons more, will help activate the frontal cortex, the temporal lobe, and the DMN. Okay. You do not need to be an expert in a creative field. You do not have to be an expert in playing guitar or have a Michelin star restaurant. No. As long as you're engaged in the creative process, then that will afford you with new creative experiences. And valuing rest and play. Okay? And this should be balanced. Okay? So rest, relaxing, but also engaging in playing, okay? Because when we rest, we're able to crystallize learned information. And when we're playing, we're able to activate to learn new things. So there are some things that we discussed today. The areas of the brain that are active during creative processes, the prefrontal cortex, the temporal lobes, and the DMN. Also, creativity is important in our daily lives because it allows us to innovate, okay, to become adaptive, and to problem solve. And these are all vital to success. Also, in the three patients that I shared with you today, they all use creativity for connections, for understanding, and more importantly, for healing. I just want to say that creativity is a natural aspect of our lives. I think that we are born with it. And I hope that today's presentation will give you some insight to achieve your creative potential. Thank you very much for your time.